Hello, everyone. Welcome to our annual public meeting. My name is Jody Allair. I'm the Director of Community Engagement at Birds Canada. And thank you so much for joining us today. We've got an absolutely fantastic session. I just wanted to talk about a couple things, and then we're going to jump right into it. The first thing I would like to say is that we're going to be recording this session for those who are unable to attend. So just so you know, this will be recorded. We have a chat function and a Q&A function. I know a lot of people have done lots of Zoom webinars over the past few years. Please feel free to jump on the chat. Let us know where you're coming in from. And the Q&A, that's where you can be putting any of your questions throughout this session. We will try to answer some as we go through the next hour, hour and 10 minutes, but we'll also have a dedicated section at the very end just to do Q&As. We'll be doing three presentations. We're going to be starting off with our president and CEO, Patrick Nadeau. And then we're going to have our two featured speakers, Allison Manthorne and Morgan. And we're going to be talking about insects and how insects and birds are doing and the challenges they're facing. But before we get started, I do want to jump in with a land acknowledgement. I'm hosting this webinar today from Treaty 7 territory, the ancestral and traditional territory of the Blackfoot Confederacy, the Kenai, Piikani, and Siksika, as well as the Tsuut'ina First Nation and the Stoney Nakoda First Nation, and on the traditional territory of the Métis Nation of Alberta, Region 3. I recognize the land as an act of reconciliation and gratitude to those on whose territory we reside. And with that, let's get started. First up, Patrick Nadeau. Patrick?
Of course I'm going to start a webinar on mute. Thanks so much, Jody. Bonjour tout le monde. Before I launch into it, je vais juste répéter quelques consignes que Jody vous a données en français. Vous connaissez la chanson rendue là. Évidemment, si vous avez des questions pendant la présentation, vous pouvez les insérer soit dans le chat ou soit dans le formulaire de questions et réponses. On va répondre à quelques questions tout au courant de la présentation, mais surtout à la fin, on se réserve une période pour répondre à vos questions. Bien sûr, vous fournissez vos commentaires et vos questions dans la langue de votre choix. So, welcome everybody. As Jody was saying, my name is Patrick Nadeau. I'm the president and CEO of Birds Canada. It is really awesome and humbling to see so many of you have tuned in. Several hundred at this point that I can see are registered. I was gonna say people joining us from coast to coast to coast, but in fact, I can see that we've got folks from outside Canada as well, which is awesome. I've seen Oklahoma, California, Colorado, so that's awesome, because as you know, birds know no borders. So we're open to all and happy to have you all joining us this afternoon where I am in Ontario. So today's event is a two-parter, which we're calling our annual public meeting. And it's the first time that we actually adopt this format for a meeting. So I'm just here today to share some observations about Birds Canada and our work over the past year. And then our presenters, Morgan and Allison, will have us chatting about insects and the birds that eat them. Ensemble avec vous, nous sommes la voix pour les oiseaux au Canada. Vous êtes des dizaines de milliers, littéralement, qui contribuent financièrement à Oiseaux Canada ou qui êtes impliqués dans nos nombreux programmes de sciences participatives. Que ce soit le projet Feeder Watch, eBird Canada, l'inventaire canadien des plongeons UR, le recensement des oiseaux de Noël, les atlas des oiseaux nicheurs et j'en passe. Vos contributions font une réelle différence sur le terrain pour nos oiseaux et pour leurs habitats. So, our work at Birds Canada falls under six strategic program areas. Unfortunately, I won't have time today to tell you about all the great work we're up to under each of those program areas, but how convenient, we are just releasing our 2022-23 annual impact report. So, please, I invite you to have a look. The link to that report is being pasted into the chat feature as I speak. And in there, you'll find a whole bunch of highlights of our work from coast to coast to coast under each of these six program areas. And for those of you who like to take bird photos and send them our way, thank you so much. who knows, you might even see some of your own photos in our annual report this year. So please be sure to check it out. On le sait tous, la décennie dans laquelle nous nous trouvons est critique pour la planète. À Montréal, en décembre dernier, la communauté internationale s'est fixé des objectifs ambitieux en matière de protection de la nature à l'horizon 2030. Mais ça ne va pas arriver tout seul. On doit pousser. All of us, all of you on this webinar know it. We urgently need to advance solutions to the dual biodiversity and climate crises. Canada has set ambitious targets on the world stage for halting and reversing the loss of biodiversity on a 2030 timeline. That is only 7 years away. And it won't happen without all actors pushing for it to happen, and that includes Birds Canada. So that's why we're ramping up our engagement and our support of Indigenous-led conservation right across the country. That's also why we're ramping up our international partnerships to address conservation challenges with migratory birds, which know no borders. That's also why we've ramped up our capacity and our budget to meet this unprecedented challenge. This year, as an organization, Birds Canada is nearing a $10 million annual budget. That's our largest ever. And in the chat box, for those who are interested, you'll find a link to our audited financial statements, which we're proud to make available publicly for all to see. And finally, that's why we're ramping up our program area, which seeks to recover species of highest concern. Which brings me to today's topic on aerial insectivores. And I'm very excited for you all to hear it. And it's a topic we've picked quite deliberately because along with grassland birds, aerial insectivores are a top focus bird group for Birds Canada. And it's really all hands on deck. In Ontario, Quebec, and the Maritimes, for example, we're helping community members become champions and conservation stewards for chimney swifts. In British Columbia, we're working to unravel the mysteries of the elusive and endangered black swift. In southern Ontario, we just finished a successful field season of fitting threatened whippoorwills with MODIS tags so that we can better understand their migration journeys. And those are just a few of the numerous initiatives that mobilize many of our staff and volunteers around these amazing and imperiled birds that we call aerial insectivores. So just before I turn it over to our presenters on this particular topic, I want to take a final moment to sincerely thank all of you on behalf of the entire team at Birds Canada for being here today, of course, but really for being here with us every single day as supporters, as volunteers, as followers of our work. It means a great deal to us, and frankly, it gives us a lot of pride in the work that we do, knowing that we're all doing it together for the birds. So please know that we always want to hear from you with your feedback, with your ideas, and of course with your photos, and that includes me personally, so please don't hesitate to reach out. I'll be here at the end of today's webinar as well if you have any questions for me about my work or Birds Canada's work. Je serai ici jusqu'à la fin de la session aujourd'hui si jamais vous avez des questions pour moi, ça me fera un grand plaisir. Et sur ce, Jody, je te repasse le flambeau. Back over to you, Jody.
Thanks very much, Patrick. I'm going to jump right in and do introductions to our two incredible speakers we've got lined up today. And just a reminder, there's a lot of people here, a lot of great stuff in the chat. Please let us know where you're from. I know people are still coming into the session today, which is great. We've got a really great turnout. And please note that the Q&A section is the place for your questions. So please add any of your questions there throughout this presentation, and we will get to those either during the session or right at the end during the Q&A. So we've got two speakers today. Our first one that I'm going to highlight is Allison Manthorne. Allison is the aerial insectivore conservation strategist at Birds Canada, working with our conservation monitoring, outreach, and communication programs across Canada to collaboratively build a national aerial insectivore conservation plan. But first up, we're going to hear from Dr. Morgan Jackson. Morgan is an entomologist, natural historian, and educator at McGill University. He is fascinated by flies and has spent his career studying the taxonomy, systematics, and ecology of insects, particularly in Canada, and telling the story of biodiversity one species at a time. And with that, let's hear from Morgan. Thanks for being here, Morgan.
Hi, thanks for having me. Let me get myself all organized here, like I know what I'm doing. Sorry about that. Okay. I think things should be good now. Hopefully everybody can see the screen. Thank you so much for having me, Birds Canada, and thank you to everybody who's joining this presentation today. It's great to see so many people interested in Canadian biodiversity, even if it's birds that you're really drawn to. But I hope by the end of this little talk and us talking about it, you'll have a newfound appreciation for bugs and the things that they're going through as well. So at this point, I think everybody's kind of got that question of why are we talking about bugs? Well, obviously bugs form a major component of Canada's biodiversity and all the systems that go into those ecosystems. So we've also heard a lot in the news about this idea of an insect apocalypse. Right, we've had lots of big news stories about this that seem to come up every couple of months, where another new magazine or major news report will come out saying, talking about how the insect apocalypse is here, collapse of insects are going extinct, we'll never have insects again. What does this mean for everybody? And this is a great topic. It's very important. I don't want to minimize it in any way, but it's a lot of it has come because of a study that came out of Germany, was the one really kickoff point. Now, obviously, entomologists and scientists across the world have been recognizing insect loss and declines. We haven't been able to like really nail down what those numbers mean, but you know, people have noticed it. Our windshields aren't as buggy when we drive across the country as we feel like they used to. When we're sitting out at a nightlight looking for moths, maybe we're not getting quite as many as we expected to see. So these anecdotes were starting to pile up. And so this group in Germany, which is basically a group of amateurs, and I don't mean that in a bad way, I mean just they're not professional entomologists, they get paid to do a day job. And in their spare time, they collected insects all across Germany. And basically by using the biomass, how much their samples weighed from year to year and from place to place, they made this discovery that this huge loss of biomass across Germany, 75% was what they found. And so this is the graph from that. This kicked off this whole cycle of insects are declining, not just in the public media, but also in the scientific research. And we see lots and lots and lots and lots of studies coming out in the last 5 or 6 years, all trying to examine this. Because when the public kind of noticed this from this study, we all realized we didn't have good answers for anybody. And that's partly because science is hard, ecology is hard. And more importantly, we don't know a lot about bugs. You know, they're small, they're hard to identify, they're hard to understand what they're doing and studying and figuring that out. And because of that, we don't have great baseline data. That data that says, before things started changing, here's what it should have looked like. And we didn't have a lot of long-term trend data. So what we had was a lot of studies coming out from all over the world, mostly in Europe, but all over the world, really, saying, we think there's maybe a decline here. We don't know why. Then you find another study saying, we don't find a decline here. I don't know why. And then we looked at different taxa, and they were usually pretty broad. So we would look just at beetles and say, beetles are declining. Or we'd look just at moths and say, moths are declining. And we try and come up with some ideas for what that is. And so this is the paper that sort of kicked off this new trend of it. Fortuitously for this talk, they just published an update to that paper in the journal Nature last week, Thursday, so a week ago today. And basically what they did is they reanalyzed their data. They added back in the data that they have collected since they published, so in the last 5 or 6 years. And that's what the colored bars on the right are, is the data since publication. And what they found, just to muddy up the waters even more, is that the trend goes away with the last 3 years worth of data. This declining trend goes away. And what they found instead is that population levels are fluctuating almost entirely based on the weather. You know, having a good, nice, warm spring, having wet, rainy conditions makes more bugs. I think we can all probably guess that that's what we would have suspected a little bit. We have a especially rainy season here, at least out where I am in, outside of Montreal. And we had a ton of mosquitoes. We had a ton of other bugs, but we had a cold spring. So when I was out collecting all summer, I was seeing very, very few bugs compared to last year when we had huge numbers of bugs. So this is just a point. I'm not saying that there is not a decline. What I'm saying is we don't know. It's so hard. We don't know what is going on. We're doing our best. There are hundreds and hundreds of scientists all across the world trying to figure out what is going on, trying to find some way to cut through the noise of the system and figure out what is happening. Are we losing insects? Probably. How are we losing them? We don't know. Why are we losing them? How can we change it? And so this continues to go on into the Canadian system as well. So because this is Birds Canada's talk, and because I'm situated in Canada and familiar with the talk of that, I'm going to stick to what I know. And that's the birds in my backyard, or sorry, the bugs in my backyard. God, the bird virus is setting in. So mostly talking about the bugs that is in my backyard here in Canada, also broadly. So the things that we're going to talk about are going to look further and further along. And this idea of we don't know is not new. This is a quote that I love from a paper or from an entire book called Canada and its Insect Fauna. That was really, really important piece of work, basically setting out and documenting what we knew about insects, particularly their diversity, in 1979. And this was an early project from the Biological Survey of Canada, which I am currently serving as the president of. And so this quote, I think, rings true for a lot of what we're talking about. This is 45 years ago. This paper has been more a declaration of ignorance of the real changes in the insect, recent changes in the insect fauna, than a description or explanation of those changes that may have taken place. And I can't make it any better than that. So we're going to talk about some of the ideas, some of the things that we think are going on, but frankly, we're kind of still working on it and don't really have a good idea. So 40 years later, we're kind of in the same spot. Maybe things are changing. We're guessing things are changing. How exactly? We're not fully sure. So how many bugs are there in Canada? Let's start there, because that's an important question. And so this is a new paper, series of papers that came out that was organized by the Biological Survey of Canada, and they were published in 2019 in the journal Zookies. They're all open access. I encourage you to go look through them. And basically what the scientists across Canada did was broke down and figured out how many insects are there in Canada? How many species of insects are there in Canada across all the different orders? So the orders being higher than species, higher than genus, higher than family, the big classification that you basically can recognize when you're walking across the street. So you've got flies and wasps and bees and beetles and butterflies and spiders and bugs and then a whole bunch of other stuff that kind of gets lumped into a tiny little corner, but is still super important. And so this is a continuation of that 1979 work. And at the 1979, we knew of about 33,000 species in Canada. So over those 45 years, we added 11,000 species to our understanding of Canada's biodiversity. And you can see, much to my pleasure, that Diptera are the number one taxa in Canada. Beetles get a lot of play in the tropics, but Canada is a land of flies. And you can see that just in Canada, we've got darn near as many species of flies in Canada as there are birds globally. So birds, small players on the biodiversity landscape of Canada. In fact, if I put it another way, if you look up at the Socodia, the thing that's picking up 1.3% of that graph, those are the lice, both the plant lice and the true sucking lice. And if we split that down the middle, basically what I can say is that there are as many sucking lice, the things like you get in your hair, your kids may get in your hair, as well as all the feather lice and things that affect mammals and birds. There's as many of those in Canada as all of the breeding birds in Canada. In fact, the lice outnumber the birds a little bit. So if we're just talking about birds versus bugs, here's a good reference for it. So all the little nitpicking, literal nitpicking lice outnumber birds in Canada for species diversity. And everything beyond that is just added on top. So when I say that Canada is a nation of bugs, this is kind of what I mean. And yes, I picked the derpiest looking photos, illustrations of birds, because I shine up the lice a little bit compared to birds, because they are so underrated. But now if we look at what we don't know, what we think we don't know, because the scientists in this Biological Survey of Canada project also estimated what we thought we didn't know. And those numbers were huge. So here we have that same chart. The colors are the same numbers, the same percentages as what was before. But now we've added in the estimate of what we still haven't discovered. And we think we're just at barely over half. We've only discovered or started to record about half of the species of insects in Canada, a little bit more than that, although the number fluctuates a lot. There's some groups that were tens to 20,000 maybe coming up. Huge, huge numbers of fluctuations going on here. And we're just trying to figure this out and still working on understanding what means biodiversity in Canada, right? And so looking at this number and thinking, good gosh, no wonder we don't know what most of them are doing. We don't even know what, barely know what most of them are to begin with, right? So trying to figure out how those population trends are, entomology is so far behind the game compared to birds and birding. in this case. And so let's go through a couple of those ideas, these bigger ideas and trends that have been pointed at in other parts of the world. Canada's contributions to the decline of insects is relatively on a species by species basis. We know some things about some of our more charismatic species like monarch butterflies and some Odonata dragonflies, and particularly bumblebees, which we'll come to in a little bit. But for when we're talking general trends, we're going to listen to what other countries are doing. And you're going to see that the themes of what is potentially causing decreases in bugs in Canada are going to be very similar to the things that are being pointed to for decreases in birds in other places. So we have very much aligned interests in this case. So the first one to talk about is light pollution. Now, this is a baseball diamond about 5 minutes from my house. I live down along the St. Lawrence River in Quebec, just outside of Montreal. And this baseball diamond is literally 15 feet from the river. The river, the most natural portion of it, the part with all the rapids that boats haven't been able to get to, and that has had a large ecological and cultural connection for a long time. And this baseball diamond is sitting right next to it. And I walked past one night on my way home from work, and I looked up and I saw this huge cloud of insects just swarming around these bright halogen lights. And everybody knows that this is the case. In fact, I know people who go and find these lights to go find insectivorous birds that might be hanging around before, after, and during to go pick off all these bugs. But light pollution is being fingered as one of the major, or as a significant contributor to declines in nocturnal insects. Moths, a lot of the aquatic insects that are flying here, most of these are midges and mayflies and stoneflies, all the things that live in the river, come out in big swarms, get sucked up by the light, basically thinking that the moon is suddenly a lot closer than it used to be, and they're circling their way and navigating and get circled into it like a moth to a flame, literally. And this is where light pollution can have a big effect, and street lights and street lamps and house lighting and big buildings, the same as birds get distracted by, bugs get distracted by them too. Now, of course, swarming in these huge numbers is also an important factor for bug biology. And obviously, bird swarms are popular, and we see big, lovely pictures of starlings murmurating, but bugs do it too. So what I like to call midgemurations are basically swarms of insects. And everybody's familiar with midges. You're going to be biking down a trail, or you're sitting in your backyard. I know right around here, every spring, summer, and fall, every couple of weeks, there's a new cloud of bugs sitting, hanging out across the apple trees and across the big tall trees and going up and down the road. And I walk through them and they start following my head. Basically, what's happening there is those are big mating swarms. So all of the bugs have come out of one species, have come out of the river at the same time, and have gone to one place. And they have a huge fidelity for those places. So there might be a tree that this species of bug in this area has been going to for tens, dozens, hundreds of years. That is the tree. That is the hotspot. And the swarms are generally made up of mostly males, male flies or male caddisflies. And the females will come in, the males will do a thing to try and attract them, grab them, and go off and mate. So these swarms can get to huge sizes and quantities, and they're basically full of flies that look like this, which when you see them up close, instead of batting them out of your face and trying to spit them out of your mouth as you're walking along the pathway, they're actually pretty cool and cute. And midges like this, they're in the family Chironomidae. These are hugely diverse in Canada, thousands of species here in Canada that we know of, and they're wildly important to a lot of ecosystems, particularly aquatic ecosystems. And so you can see this is a male here with a big fluffy antenna that he's using to sense the surroundings, to basically smell the air, find where the cool stuff is and where the females are, and zoom in and join those mating swarms. So the adults are the part that are flying around, but the larvae are spending months or years mostly in the water, in aquatic environments. And that's the larvae there you see on the right. That's the bloodworm. That's red because they usually live in fairly oxygen poor locations down in the soil, in anaerobic conditions where there's not as much oxygen. So they have independently evolved a molecule in their hemolymph, which is what we call bug blood, that is very, very similar to the hemoglobin that we use to capture oxygen, which is what makes them red and why they're often called bloodworms, because they look like they're full of blood. But in fact, it's their own blood. They're not drinking blood. These are non-biting midges, both as adults and as larvae. And they're just going about their life. These are kind of the aerial plankton of the natural history world, where they're going out and getting eaten by everything at this scale. both as adults and as larvae. The larvae are doing all sorts of stuff, cleaning up environments, eating soils and detritus in the water. Some of them are parasitic, some of them are predators. Literally anything you can imagine, a chironomid is doing it. In fact, they also get to be the largest land animal native to Antarctica is a chironomid midge. So penguins don't count. They don't spend the whole year there, but chironomids do. So chironomids are the largest land animal in Antarctica. Now, it's still pretty small. It's not super large, but when you're talking about Antarctica, you get what you count. So midges are super important. Ecologically, they're massively important. And their aquatic environments are what are really, really important. Those aquatic environments provide them the place, the daycare that allows their babies to live and survive and move on. And they can do a lot in really bad places, bad polluted places. But what we're finding is that pesticides in particular, especially neonicotinoids, are really bad, really hard on aquatic invertebrates, both midges and all the other bugs that you find in the rivers and lakes and streams and ponds around Canada. Things like dragonfly larvae, things like mayflies and stoneflies and caddisflies, all the things that, you know, that are important for fishers that are using fly fishing, things that are coming out and buzzing around your house and your lights at the weekend, all these things that are living in those water. This is the reason, these are the bugs that led to the neonicotinoid ban from the Canadian government in 2016. There's a lot of talk about pollinators, bees and flies and wasps that are doing flower associated in agricultural systems. But really the PMRA, which is the government agency that regulates pesticides, looked at the aquatic insects and said, wow, this is really bad for them. This is really, really hurting them. We got to cut out our neonicotinoids. And that was in 2016. However, by 2021, they've basically backtracked on a lot of that. And neonicotinoids are now still mostly allowed in most agricultural systems. They have some regulations and some strong regulations about how close they can be used to streams and how much can be used. But really, pesticides are a big problem for especially aquatic insects like midges that then go on to become aerial insects. And another person, so this is Dr. Aaron Fairweather. They just finished their PhD at the University of Guelph, my own alma mater. And they did a whole lot of really cool work, first in time in the world, looking at ants in agricultural systems. So ants being the soil engineers of most agricultural systems. And what Aaron did is they basically dosed them with neonicotinoids. And then they found that the ants are incredibly susceptible to neonicotinoids, where they have huge levels of mortality very quickly to very, very small amounts. Like we're talking like less than 5% of an actual real seed treatment for the field. We're talking about fractions of an actual real world dosage, and the ants are just getting wiped out. Ants, of course, being when they enter their aerial reproductive stage, another important insectivorous bird food stuff. So now we're just barely figuring out that neonicotinoids in an agricultural landscape are also equally bad for the ants. And of course, we get back into habitat loss and introduced diseases. And this is where we come back to pollinators like the bumblebees. And a lot of work on this in Canada has been done by Dr. Sheila Kala, who is at York University. And she's done a huge amount of work looking both through museum collections as trying to establish that baseline of how many bumblebees did we have? What were their populations like 50, 100, 150 years ago? And what are they like today? How do we kind of build up and figure out that baseline data, figuring out what it was supposed to be like before we came along and maybe have messed things up? And she's done a lot of work on this, both on the rusty patch bumblebee, which is a species that has been pretty much extirpated from Canada. We haven't seen it in Canada for, I think, 10 or 15 years. And she's now working more and more on the American bumblebee, which is going and following that same trend where we're seeing fewer and fewer of them hanging around and they're being pushed out of Canada in a lot of similar way. And the reasons are still unknown fully, but the reasonings are starting to aim towards being habitat loss. We're getting rid of the habitat that they need, grasslands and prairies, and agriculture is still usually pretty good for it. But we're also starting to introduce diseases primarily from managed bees like the honeybee. So honeybees, kind of just cows, right? They are livestock, but they come in because they're high density. They come in with a lot of diseases and parasites, and we're finding that those diseases and parasites are being transferred to the wild bees, who are not supposed to be getting those diseases and those parasites, and that's really starting to also hamper their ability. And so Dr. Kala has been doing a lot of work in and around Toronto and Southern Ontario with community science, with their bumblebee watch program, that is helping to bring people out and finding these bumblebees and trying to give us an idea of where they're from, where they can be found now, where they aren't being found now, and why those reasons might be tied together. And so what do we do? So now I've pointed to a couple of things, and they're all bird related types of things. So what do we do from here? Well, first we got to start building these long-term monitoring projects. There's no time like the present to actually start getting onto this, so that 10, 15, 30 years from now, we have a better idea. We can no longer say, well, we're kind of ignorant. We don't know what we're doing. Maybe they're coming or going. Now we can start, we should be starting and building these projects now and being like, here is our baselines. Are they late? Yes. Are they better than none? Yes. So let's start doing that. So we need funding, we need people, we need all the organizations to come together and start working on building large scale population stuff, basically replicating what the bird world has done for themselves. We also, of course, need to continue documenting our biodiversity, helping fund taxonomy and natural history, and going out and finding what is there, museum science, and recognizing the species that are still right underneath our feet, which we haven't recognized yet. We find dozens and dozens and dozens every year, including through community science and iNaturalist. Huge, huge win for this. Of course, we now need to start engaging with communities, industries, and municipalities, including Indigenous communities, on figuring out what all this means, how to go about collecting data, why it's important, and what we're going to do about it, and how we're going to change the systems to enable better protections for insects at that very baseline. And of course, why I'm here today is to help coordinate with places like Birds Canada and other organizations across Canada and globally to start figuring out and understanding what it is we're doing as a species, how we're affecting everything else, and how we can change and figure out a way to go about and make things different for entomology and biodiversity. So that's all I got for you today. Thank you so much. If you're interested in following along, I've mentioned and referenced the Biological Survey of Canada multiple times. Have a look at the website. Check us out. Join us. It's a free organization. We don't do a lot, but we're trying to ramp up. Join us there. Learn more about bugs. Thank you so much for having me today. And I enjoy birds just as much as bugs. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Morgan. That was really fantastic. And, you know, as someone who considers himself an amateur insect enthusiast, I think it's really great that we're able to talk about insects and outside the context of just being food source for birds. Insects are so important to everything, all parts of the ecosystem. So it was really great. And I don't know how you couldn't think that close up of a midge isn't the cutest thing ever. Midges are, I think, super cute insects. So we're going to move on to the bird side of things. I just wanted to remind people again that you may have seen in the chats that we're putting lots of links to lots of papers and things that Morgan was talking about during his presentation are going to be embedded in the chat. And so just to let everyone know, we will be following up with all folks that have registered here, and we will be providing all of these links as well afterwards. So you will get to see some of this stuff. So so you don't have to worry about that if you don't have time to copy and paste those. All right, so now we're going to go from the deep dive into what we know and what we don't know about insect populations, and we're going to make the switch to talking about birds, particularly aerial insectivores. And lucky for us, we've got the amazing Allison here to tell us all about this. So Allison, take it away.
Thanks so much, Jody. I'm just going to get set up here. And thank you, Morgan, for introducing me to the term midgemeration. That's priceless. Okay, are we good? Good. All right. Well, thank you very much, Morgan, for basically setting up my talk for me and covering a lot of the content that's hard to get into at a technical level in terms of the effects of neonicotinoids. But I will follow up with some of these points that you've brought up, but from a bird perspective. So I'll get right into it here. Let's give a primer on what aerial insectivores are. Now, if you've registered for this, you already have figured out that aerial insectivores are birds that depend on a diet of aerial insects. So what that means is these birds are eating flying insects while they're in flight. And some birds are hawkers, which means some of those, you know, swallows and swifts that you might see high up in the sky, they're soaring around. And if insects are aerial plankton, then these birds would be almost the baleen whales of the bird world. And so if you could take a snapshot of one of these birds as it's looking for food, what you would find is, zooming in, maybe a swift has a very small looking beak, or a nightjar has a really small looking beak. But when that bird is opening up its gape, it is huge, and it's able to just kind of grab those insects and then store them in this little special throat pouch. And then it brings that bolus of food back to the nest and delivers it to the young. And so aerial insectivores are by and large very specialized in their body morphology. They have long, kind of pointed, sharp wings, almost like fighter jets, and very good vision, big eyes, and the ability to kind of bank and turn in order to pursue these insects that sometimes are very rapidly trying to escape. And so some of these birds are what we call the hawkers, and some are the salliers, and people might be familiar with maybe kingbirds or some of the flycatchers that are sitting out on a branch kind of surveying the landscape. And when they see something that they want to pursue, they go out and nab it and bring it back and maybe beat it over a stick to subdue it. Some people might actually point out that aerial insectivores are not just birds. And so dragonflies are aerial insectivores, right? And bats are aerial insectivores. They're also pursuing these insects while in flight. But for today, when I talk about aerial insectivores, I'm talking about the birds. And so what these birds have in common are this aerial insect diet. But then if you dive deeper, these are actually a very diverse guild of birds. And so most of them are not closely genetically related. If you think about swifts and swallows, often if you go to one of my favorite birding haunts is the sewage lagoon, because there's a lot of good bugs and birds there. You'll either get what I mean or you'll be horrified, but you can usually see swifts and swallows there together, and they might forage in a flock together. And they're not actually closely related, but because they are eating the same insects, they're gathering together, and because they have that same kind of fighter jet body shape, it can be hard to tell them apart. But one of the things I like to tell people is that chimney swifts are actually more closely related to hummingbirds. And so, yeah, there's a lot of diversity within this guild. Zooming out to their kind of full life cycle, some of the aerial insectivores travel a fairly short distance from their wintering grounds to their breeding grounds. So maybe, you know, some of them are flying down to Florida or Central America and then breeding in parts of the US and Canada. And then others are making these incredibly long journeys from maybe Northern Canada all the way to South America. And so there's quite a difference in the kind of the amount of mileage these birds are getting over the course of the year and over the course of their lifespan. And that can have implications, and I'll talk to about that in a little bit. And also the habitats that aerial insectivores actually require for breeding is also really diverse. So the most obvious example would be the chimney swift, and that bird is so named because its primary habitat in modern times is now chimneys. They rely on these dark kind of sheltered habitats inside brick or stone chimneys generally, and their entire body is adapted to using these structures. They've got these huge toes with big sharp claws, and they're using those like woodpeckers do to kind of cling onto the chimney. And they've even got spikes on their tails to act as braces. And they're really really reliant on this habitat. Now, historically, it would have been hollow trees, but those really are not prevalent on our landscape anymore. And then on the other kind of end of things, you've got bank swallows that are digging their own nest cavities in vertical banks, like maybe along lake bluffs or coastal beach cliffs or along riverbanks. And then you've got some of the nightjars that are just plunking down a nest scrape in kind of an open habitat in a forest clearing, or even on the roof of a building with a gravel roof. So in terms of kind of what these birds all need for their nesting habitat, it's quite varied. And I'll talk about the threats as well and how those kind of affect all of these birds in different ways. So unfortunately, that common thread that ties aerial insectivores together, the aerial insects, is probably one of the main drivers of their decline. And this graph here, this little infographic, I just wanted to bring up, that's from the State of Canada's Birds from 2019. And a lot of the data that were used to produce this were actually collected by volunteers that were contributing to citizen science programs. And so I just wanted to underscore how important it is for to have all of the volunteer participation in these programs. It really does drive drive our understanding of these declines. And so this infographic here really shows you how poorly aerial insectivores have been doing in the last few decades. And so if you can see that line on the bottom, it's kind of that light purple mauve. That is a summary of the aerial insectivore population decline since the 1970s. And we usually use the 1970s as a starting point because that's where a lot of the breeding bird survey data begin. And so it's possible that birds were also declining before this, but that's kind of our starting point. And so this points a pretty grim picture, as you can see. And it's really put the spotlight on what it is that's driving these drastic declines in this particular group of birds. So in 2020, this paper was published, and it kind of synthesized some of the ways that aerial insectivores are being affected by individual threats or kind of the compounding threats, and what it is that we can do to kind of identify where they're slipping through the cracks, and then what are some helpful actions that we can take either as individuals, community groups, or at a higher kind of municipal, provincial, or federal level, or international. And so this is maybe a quick and dirty overview of some of the threats that I mentioned before, but it's a good summary, and it touches on some of the points that Morgan made. So for aerial insectivores, habitat loss is a really important driver of declines. And when we talk about habitat loss, we're talking about the nesting habitat that these birds depend on. And as you can imagine, that because of the diversity of nesting habitat, it is affecting aerial insectivores at different rates. And so for a bird like the chimney swift that has already lost its old growth forest habitat, has adapted to human-built habitat, and is now seeing a pretty steep decline in the availability of human-built habitat like chimneys, because humans don't even use chimneys anymore. That's been a big stressor on the population of chimney swifts. But also, habitat includes the food that the bird needs and the places that the bird needs for resting and for stopovers. And so wetlands are included in there because wetlands are hugely important for a number of bird species, both during the breeding season and as almost like the pantry that they need to use to source their food. Morgan referenced those midges. And midges are really important. They're a really high quality food source. They have these long chain fatty acids that other insects that are terrestrial based don't have. And that can make an impact on kind of the health of nestlings when adults are provisioning food. And so if we're losing wetlands or we're degrading our wetlands, that is basically degrading the food source. But also, for anybody who's been to Long Point, Ontario, you may have been lucky enough to see these amazing aggregations of swallows that are gathering together in the fall. So cattail marshes and other marshes that have kind of a complex structure are very good for birds to use as a stopover site. Overnight, when they need to rest, they or in bad weather, they're flying down into these cattail marshes. They're spending the night along with other birds, like, you know, blackbirds, and they're basically safe and hidden away in these wetlands. And so when we lose those wetlands, we're losing those really important roosting sites. Habitat degradation is also really important, not only because the kind of lower quality of habitat when it gets polluted by pesticides or changes in other ways. And so habitat degradation is a bit of a complex one, but the other one that kind of ties in closely to habitat degradation, or maybe as a driver of habitat degradation, is climate change. And climate change is a huge issue that is so multifaceted, and I'm not going to touch on it too much here because I think maybe we'll get into it with the question and answer period. But the effects that we're seeing on birds and insects are multiple. And so, for example, we're seeing in Atlantic Canada for sure more frequent and more powerful storms coming up. And that can actually bring birds back up as they're migrating south and kind of make them expend their energy. It can also lead to these long periods of drought, heat waves, or rainy spells. And for birds that depend on these aerial insects, if they are waiting out a storm or kind of a rainy week, and this year in the Maritimes, we certainly had our fair share of really rainy weather, and they're not able to provision their nests, and sometimes we're seeing higher nestling mortality or starvation, and those kind of increasing unpredictable weather events can over time have a big impact on birds. Heat waves are another one. Sometimes that will also cause insects to be less active, and so that can also either stress the bird because the bird is burning too much energy trying to thermoregulate, but also sometimes being deprived of its food. And the loss of insects obviously is what brought us here together today. And this one is, as Morgan said, really complex. It's not something that we've figured out and we haven't figured out the solutions to. We're really just scratching the surface of what it is, how different species of aerial insectivores are being impacted by loss of insects or lower quality insects if they're being impacted by pesticides or heavy metals or mercury in some cases. And so not only can insect loss have a negative effect on birds through the very obvious, cause and effect of birds not having insects to eat and birds not having insects to feed their young, but also if insects are kind of bioaccumulating toxins. And bioaccumulation is a process where an organism is somehow absorbing a toxin and retaining it in their body and then being eaten by another organism that's subsequently taking up that toxin, and it kind of moves up the food chain. And so we're seeing this in birds as well. And so what can happen then if a aerial insectivore is not being poisoned outright by a toxin? It can also still have kind of these chronic, long-lasting effects, either on the growth of the bird or its nestlings, sometimes hampering immune response, can also have negative effects on the reproductive ability of that bird, and even the ability of birds to navigate. So when they're heading south, not really being able to orient, and that obviously has really negative consequences on migration. So this is all to say that there are several threats that are impacting several species in several regions to varying degrees. And it's really complex. And it's something that my colleagues are working on across Canada. And depending on partnerships like we're talking about today with entomologists, with agronomists, and with industries to try to figure out solutions, to try to tie the research that is being done with on-the-ground solutions and stewardship or policy options. So that just brings me to kind of the Bird Canada side of things. So what we aim to do to support aerial insectivore conservation and recovery is develop tools that allow landowners or land managers to effectively steward birds, and to get out the message to a wide range of people who may or may not feel that this affects them. We're also advocating for sound government policy and legislation that actually reduces threats to birds. Morgan mentioned the neonic ban and the subsequent reversal. And so that's something that we're studying and trying to figure out ways to advocate for lower risk and lower exposure to pesticides in not just the agricultural industry, but, you know, in municipalities, in forestry operations. As I mentioned, our citizen science really drives a lot of this work and highlights, you know, how the work that we're doing is affecting the birds. And so we really need strong monitoring programs. And what that means is they have to be user-friendly. People have to actually sign up and feel like they're able to understand it. And of course, they have to be rigorous so that we're able to see what the effects are. We're also, as Morgan said, you know, we are discovering what we don't know. And so trying to expand our staff capacity and our volunteer capacity to get at those questions and fill those knowledge gaps, of which there are many. And then we're really building linkages between programs and regions. And what I mean by that is if I have a program that has a really strong stewardship component to it, and I, you know, we've discovered ways to support our volunteers and landowners to actually be able to steward these birds, then I'm sharing those kind of wins with other people in different regions to try to get, you know, get the message out. And if there's a knowledge gap that I can help fill in my personal position as the aerial insectivore conservation strategist, what I'm really happy to be doing right now is finding all of the kind of tools that we have in our toolkit that maybe we didn't know we had, and putting them all together and coming up with these common common goals and figuring out, you know, oh, it turns out that we actually do have a really good tool to fill that. So that's what I've been doing. And then, of course, the analytical capacity. So we have, through Nature Counts, this massive data set from multiple decades, really, of work. And there's, you know, it's a gold mine, really. So being able to dig into that, having the staff and the expertise to do that, and then have that data support conservation and policy and regulations is really important. So this is where you come in. I find that in the face of headlines like, you know, the insect apocalypse or the climate doomerism headlines, it can be really discouraging. And I always have to, you know, remind myself where I fit on, I think it's Hannah Ritchie's framework. She puts people into kind of the pessimistic versus optimistic on one axis, and then complacent versus active on the other axis. And if we are what she calls doomerism advocates, and we say it's all really bad and there's not much we can do, that's obviously problematic. And then on the other hand, if we're kind of blindly optimistic and somebody else is going to sort this out, right, that's also problematic. And so what I try to do is swing kind of into the other direction with the optimistic change kind of mindset. And so, yes, we have major data gaps and knowledge gaps. We have sometimes problematic policies or practices, but we also have a really strong history of solving big complex problems like, you know, the DDT crisis. And so, sorry, the train is coming, so it might be a little bit loud. But from an individual perspective, what is it that we can do? Number one, the easiest thing to do is just start where you are. If you are not really confident with your bird ID, just pick a bird, you know, learn what it sounds like. If you can listen to a chimney swift and then hear it in real life, you'll never forget that sound. It's an amazing sound. And you'll be starting to hear chimney swifts all over the place. We also have a lot of different learning resources on the Birds Canada website. There's Merlin or Bird ID by sound. And we've got, for example, our Swift and Swallow ID card. So you can download this from our website and it'll show you a lot of different species of swift swallows in Eastern Canada and what their nests look like. So just pick a bird, kind of get to know it. Join a naturalist club if you can, or a birding club or a hiking club, and just dive right in. In terms of stewardship, this is going to be one of our most effective tools, and we have some really good examples across Canada. For one, the swift and swallow friendly property signs. So swift and swallow friendly property owners are people who have identified that they have these birds on their properties and are taking steps to protect those birds and ensure that they have a safe nesting season. And so for chimney swifts, I always go back to this because I worked on chimney swifts for so many years, but it can be choosing to sweep your chimney outside of the nesting season so that it's not affecting birds. If you're not using the chimney, then just keeping it open to provide habitat for the birds, that kind of thing. And for anybody who does have swallows or swifts that they know about, you can reach out. You can look on our website and we have a request form so that you can request your own sign. And it's this kind of aluminum sign that you can post outside or inside, and it identifies you as a bird-friendly property. There's also, I think Doug Tallamy said that, he coined the phrase, backyard natural national park. And what he, I think, meant by that is that it's up to all of us to make change wherever we can. It's not a matter of just relying on protected areas to, you know, do the job and reach those conservation goals that we have. If you've got a balcony in downtown Toronto, you can plant, a planter of milkweed or something, and that will make a tiny difference. If you've got an acre, you can look up native plants in your area that are beneficial to birds. There's a whole website, bird-friendly or birdgardens.ca, and I encourage people to look it up. And just, you know, if you've got 1 square meter of space that you can work with, then that's a great place to start. And then the citizen sciences opportunities that we have are many, and I like to talk about swifts and swallows because you can see them almost anywhere that you find yourself in Canada, and most of them you can do with little or no experience, and you're making a really important conservation contribution. And then it's important also to look in your community and look at where you can advocate for change. And we're doing that at all levels of government and looking at kind of municipal policies, whether we can convince municipalities where we live to implement cosmetic pesticide bans or put, you know, bird-friendly building practices in place. And then all the way up to, as Morgan mentioned, the PMRA looking at revisiting some of those decisions on pesticide regulation. And that's where I want to leave you. I hope that there's still time for questions. And I really wanted to thank everybody for coming and for providing this opportunity to discuss aerial insectivores and insects.
All right. Thank you so much, Allison. Like, such fantastic information. And I see by the chat, I think everyone has really enjoyed listening and learning to all the information we've been getting from Morgan and Allison about not only insect declines and what we need to do for insects, but also birds and the various threats birds are facing. We are going a little bit over time, but that's okay. We are still going to set about 5 or 6 minutes still for questions. So you're welcome to hang on. There's been a lot of questions already in the Q&A. But I thought I would start with a question quickly with from Morgan and Allison, talking about some of these drivers again of what's causing these declines. We know that insects and birds are linked through a food source, but they also have shared drivers that are affecting their populations. And I know, like, one of those that we talked about, that you both talked about, was pesticide use in this country. And I think there's been lots of questions and comments in here about pesticides, what people need to do, and how do we address the issue of reducing pesticides, both at home, on a political landscape, to help birds and insects. So do either one of you want to jump on that and talk a little bit more about what people can do to help deal with this pervasive pesticide issue?
Yeah, I mean, I can jump into that. I meant to mention it during my talk, and I just want to reiterate now that you've brought it back up, is that the reasons the pesticides are there is also because of bugs. So this is not an easy issue. And you know, especially at a time when we've got crazy inflation on foodstuffs and problems growing things because of weather and climate related and international events that are changing food landscapes in big ways, right? So pesticides, unfortunately, are going to be a fact of life to feed the population. So finding that balance between getting rid of the bugs we don't want in our food production chain while minimally impacting the rest of the ecosystem is really the sweet spot here. And I'm not fully qualified. I'm not a toxicologist. Somebody like Dr. Fairweather would be way better at talking about this. This is their specialty. But you know, finding that balance between people making a living with their agriculture, us trying to eat the results of that agriculture and also us enjoying the biodiversity around us. Finding the sweet spot in there is really, really difficult, and is going to be one thing to try and figure out. And so, you know, there's no easy answers here is basically the best of it. You know, finding the right spot that gets rid of the bugs we don't want, keeps the bugs we do want, and provides us a way to feed our families for the vast majority, and hopefully sharing that broadly with communities and nations that are underserved and underfed at this point as well. So really complex, you know, there's real no good answers. You know, total bans would be great maybe for pollinators and aquatic insects, but it's going to come at a cost of greater pest loads and greater costs at the market. So really, really difficult problems is the theme of entomology is it's hard.
No, for sure. Well said. Allison, did you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, I think I agree with everything that Morgan just said. And I think we also need to take a better look at how we manage risk. Right now, I think there's room for improvement with how the transfer of some of these residues is tracked. And so, for example, neonicotinoids are used as seed coatings. The seed is put in the ground. And so, it, you know, you can say, well, the birds aren't able to eat those seeds because they're buried now, but the residue is still there. It's water soluble. It's been shown to persist in soil for quite a long time. And then it can move through the water table from where it was supposed to make an impact into the surrounding waterways. And so any wetlands that are anywhere near to where that treatment was are now going to be negatively affected. And they're also used as kind of prophylactically. So before the pest is present, it's a safety kind of backup to make sure that that those crops are not harmed by insects. So I think having a better sense of how, you know, what we expect to happen with that pesticide application, and looking beyond just some, the very kind of narrow window of how we measure impacts is really important. We need to be looking a lot more at the water quality and the impact on a wide range of invertebrates. And then from there, we need to be looking and managing the risk to all of the organisms that depend on those.
Now, well said, Allison. We've so many questions in the Q&A, which is wonderful to see. And we've had several en français. So I'm going to bring in Patrick to maybe read out and answer one of those questions. Patrick?
Sure, yeah. And before I do that, actually, I might just add to your answer, Jody, but en français. je vais peut-être répondre, moi aussi, ajouter mon petit bout à la question qui vient d'être posée par rapport aux pesticides. On a parlé d'influencer les gouvernements au niveau municipal, au niveau provincial, fédéral, mais c'est même le cas au niveau international, je vous dirais. Puis comme plusieurs d'entre vous le savez, en décembre dernier, le Canada a été l'hôte de la COP15, donc la grande conférence internationale sur la biodiversité. Et puis, à cette conférence-là, s'est décidée une entente internationale, le Global Biodiversity Framework. La cible numéro 7 dans cette entente-là parle précisément de la pollution et puis des pesticides. Donc, on parle de réduire de moitié le risque posé par les pesticides d'ici 2030. So, the Global Biodiversity Framework that was negotiated at COP15 has a whole set of targets, including target 7 that talks about reducing overall the risk posed by pollutants like pesticides by half. So there's a huge window here, even internationally, and even with our own federal government that's like subscribed to this international commitment, we are on the hook for reducing the risk posed by these chemicals by half. So what exactly that means, we need to influence that. And so really it's as Allison and Morgan were saying, all these actions need to happen from the municipal, but actually right up to the international sphere as well. And we're present at all those tables.
No, that is no, absolutely. That is excellent. Love seeing this outpouring of questions, almost too many to deal with, but I did want to touch on one. There's been a theme of questions about how people can help. And I know, Morgan, Allison, you talked about a few different ways that people can help and get involved, whether that's looking after your yard, not using pesticides, maybe getting involved in advocacy for more responsible land use. But in terms of specific programs and data collection, I thought I would just bring this back again because there's been a few questions related to what kind of projects people can get involved, not just for birds, but also for insects. So maybe we'll start with Morgan. Morgan, if people wanted to start learning more about insects or help collect data on insects, what can people do?
Really great question. So the big thing is go out and look for insects on your own. Get interested in them. You know, take those birding skills that you've got and dive into bugs. I know that it is a big ask. There's a lot of them. They're hard to identify, but you can do it. I have confidence in anybody who can tell a freaking flycatcher apart that you can tell most of the bugs apart. I will be 100% honest. So I can't tell flycatchers apart, but I'm pretty good at bugs. Okay, so that's how we can deal with it. If you got shorebirds, you're totally fine with all the other bugs. So dive in and go find those resources. So things like iNaturalist, real good, both for reporting and learning. Real good double action there. Bugguide.net is another website. I've seen some people sharing it in the chat. That's another great place to share observations and to get your feet wet and trying to learn them. I have a whole bookcase here of all sorts of books that are all super useful for identifying and learning more about bugs. So there's lots of stuff out there. Like I posted, Bumblebee Watch is a great place if you want to start contributing to understanding of bumblebee declines across Canada. And another big one, very similar to eBird, is eButterfly. Which is a project put out by the Montreal Insectarium and Carl Ottawa, and is very similar to eButterfly, where you're providing timed listings of the butterflies you encounter. Beyond that, we don't have a lot of other great sources yet. We don't have a lot of these systems in place for all the other groups. We don't have eFly yet, although we should get on that. But all these other things, we're still lacking. So just getting them onto iNaturalist, building up, learning how to collect insects. Again, we talked about declines, but like the level that you guys are going to collect will be fine. I'm 100% fine with that. So learning about collecting and learning about museums and learning about contributing data in physical and digital formats, great.
Now, excellent, excellent resources. I'm a big fan of iNaturalist. Not just a place to put things, but a great place to learn, as Morgan was saying. Allison, did you want to make any specific plugs or mentions of programs, projects that would be great for people to get involved in?
Yeah, well, I'll second iNaturalist. I have a 2-year-old, a 7-year-old, and a 10-year-old. And anytime they see an insect, they're like, "Mom, iNat that." And we've learned so much about insects and plants. They're mostly interested in the insects. And it's really opened our eyes to what's out there, even in our, you know, our yard that used to be just turf grass. We've let it go wild, and we're seeing an amazing diversity of plants and insects that I didn't know existed. And so I think that's just like, that's a really good tool to bring out your inner curiosity that maybe has been hidden for a little while, to bring it out and nurture it. On the bird side of things, the Swift and Swallow Aerial Insectivore Conservation Program always welcomes sightings and records from anybody across Canada. So if you see a bird diving down to a chimney, you should assume that we don't actually know about it. And if we do, you'd be amazed at what that information can do for the conservation of that individual nest or roost site. And for our understanding of kind of the range and population of these birds across Canada, those sightings actually end up feeding directly into recovery strategies and status assessments. Critical habitat is identified through all of this data. So it's hugely important, and it's making a really big difference.
Yeah, no, excellent. That's a fantastic last point, Allison, for sure. Any of that stuff makes such a big difference for us. We got to wrap it up soon, but I just wanted to pass to Patrick. Patrick, if there's any last thing you wanted to include or mention here?
I just want to thank our speakers and thank every one of you. Like, to have several hundred people take time out of their day to learn about aerial insectivores is awesome. And certainly we don't feel alone. I think it's really, you saw we're a science-based organization, so that part of it matters too, right? We want to make sure we get the story straight so that the actions we're putting forward and the solutions we're putting forward are science-based, right? And make the most sense given what we know. But I'm a scientist myself, so I'm allowed to say this. As scientists, we always say we need more information, and this is absolutely true, but that's not a free pass to paralyze us from action, right? And action, there is plenty. And because you're supporting us, because we have so many hundreds of people like you, we're able to actually make some moves to make it better for these birds. So hopefully next time we have an aerial insectivore talk and in the years to follow, you'll have more and more good news coming from us about how we're able to halt and reverse these losses. So thank you again so much. We look forward to your feedback as well in terms of this form, today's format. I'm seeing some go by in the chat. It's something new we were trying out, but so far so good. And this is probably not the last time. So thanks everyone. Merci beaucoup tout le monde.
Yeah, absolutely. That was really wonderful. We got the opportunity to talk about birds and insects, aerial insectivores and our declining insects. I think that's really great. And I'm glad we're not the only ones that thought that way. Thank you everyone, presenters and everyone who came to join us today. And thank you for attending our 2023 annual public meeting. So for more information on what you can do to support bird conservation and to see the full scope of work that Birds Canada does, please head to our website, birdscanada.org. Allison, Morgan, Patrick, thank you so much, and good birding, everyone.